Get your Bibles out or your phones and go to Acts chapter 17, verses 1 through 12. Let's begin. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul went in, as was his custom, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, "This Jesus, whom I proclaim to you, is the Christ." And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of devout Greeks. And not a few of the leading women. But the Jews were jealous, and taking some wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob, set the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. And when they could not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities, shouting, "These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also." And Jason received them. And they are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying, "There is another king, Jesus." And the people and the city authorities were disturbed. Then they heard these kings. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest and let them go, the brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word from all eagerness, explaining the Scriptures daily to see how things were so. Many of them therefore believed, with not a few Greek women of high standing as well as men. Let's go to God in prayer. Lord, we just want to pause and take this time out, Lord, to just come to your throne room and sit at your feet. We want to admire and acknowledge how wonderful and gracious and powerful and amazing that you are. Lord, before we even ask you for anything, we just want to recognize you for who you are, and not only for who you are, but what you have done for us and what you are doing. Lord, I ask that you prepare every heart right now for the receiving of your word. Open to your instruction and breathe life into us, Lord, and nourish our dry bones. We love you, Father. We thank you so much for what you've done to redeem us and the length that you have gone through to show how much you love us, Lord. You are so gracious, Jesus, and we don't deserve you, but you love us anyway, and we thank you, Lord, for giving us another chance to be in right standing with you, Lord. For everything that you have done, we love you, Lord, and we ask that your worship be pleasing. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God, you're so amazing. Can we just worship him? Yes. God, you're so amazing. You're so awesome that the same God, the same Jesus the Christ, that Paul and Silas, that they worshiped so many years back then in all the different cities and towns, that you're the same Jesus of Christ today. And that you have the same power, God, that you have the same authority, God. God, you are worthy to be praised, God. You are worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. And you just worship him wherever you are. Wherever you are, just worship our God, our King, our Master, our Savior, our Ruler, our everything. Lord, you are high above all, God. We
to you, Lord. We submit to you, God. For you alone are worthy. Hallelujah. You alone are worthy, God. I'm reminded, Lord, just this week as I was just in worship, Psalms 51, Lord, when David was praying and calling out to you, God, and he said, Lord, you desire a broken spirit and a contrite heart. Oh, my God. Lord God, so we come to you, Lord. We come to you, God, with all that we have. There's nothing great about us, God. There's nothing wonderful about us, but everything that we are, our entire being, our identity is found in you. So we humbly come to you, Lord, thanking you for your grace, thanking you for your mercy, God, thanking you for your love, your compassion for us. And Noel's gonna help me this morning and just talk about, Lord, here we are, gracefully broken. Lord, not just beat up and just worn out, but gracefully broken.
Yes, thank you.
Honoring you. Thank you for the breaking, Lord. Hallelujah.
Again, set me on fire. Set me on fire. Take all I have in these hands and multiply all that I am and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire. Set me on fire. So here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life, gracefully broken. Come, you all worship where you are. Oh, y'all help me sing. In all of your name, your might and love stands
strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose in me. You will forsake. You will be with me. So here I am, God, arms wide open.
walking gracefully. I'm strong when I am weak. I will be free. Your power hit work in me. I'm walking gracefully. I'm strong when I am weak. I will be free. Help me sing.
Your power hit work in me.
Oh yeah.
I'm walking gracefully. I'm strong when I am weak. I will be free. Your power at work in me.
Your power.
I'm
thank you for breaking me, Jesus, gracefully.
Tell him, God, here I am. Lord, here I am. This song is a song of surrender. Lord, here I am. I'm pouring out my life.
Gracefully broken.
One more time, say,
here I am.
Here I am.
God, arms wide open.
I give you everything, Lord. Hallelujah. You're worthy, God.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me.
Thank you, Lord.
And you've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it, but still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah. Your foe, still your love fought for me. You've been so, so good to me. Yeah, Jesus. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You've been so, so kind to me. Yeah. In all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, and oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. In all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, yeah. You won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me.
Overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And I simply believe that God's love isn't reckless because he's careless or that he's sloppy, but he's very intentional about what he does. But the reckless part comes in because he chose me. The Bible tells us about a shepherd who has 100 sheep and one strays from the flock. But he leaves the 99 to go get that one. Now some of y'all may be thinking it's just one sheep. It don't matter what's the value in that one when you've got 99. Surely 99 outweighs one. But God is so loving. He's so compassionate. He's so gracious. Because I was that one. I was the one who strayed away. I was the one who wanted to go my own way. I was the one thought that I knew what was best for my life. But his love is so large that he left the 99 and he came for me. And let me tell you, I ran. I don't know about you and your story, but I ran. I tried to hide. I was like, Lord, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. I don't want to let you down. Why me, Lord? Why me? That's why the next part of this song is, when we get those lyrics on the screen, it just says that there's no shadow he won't light up. There's no mountain he won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall he won't kick down. I mean, he turned down walls to come after me. He will do whatever it takes to come after me. He calls me his beloved. He calls me his own. God, I'm grateful. So wherever you are, I encourage you, look at the words, look at the lyrics, and you have to make it personal for you. That there is no shadow that God will light up for you in the darkest of your darkest nights, in the lowest of your lowest moments, in the deepest parts of your valley. He's there. He's coming after you. God, I'm so grateful for your love. I'm so grateful for your love. I'm so grateful, God, that you did so much for me and I wasn't worthy. I'm still not worthy. So wherever you are, call out to God and just say, there's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me.
Yes.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after little old me. Hey. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Help me say, there's no shadow.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
There's no wall you won't kick down,
there's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Sing it wherever you are, it's personal.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
There's no wall you won't kick down,
no wall you won't kick down,
lie you won't tear down. Oh, see, there's no shadow you won't light up,
there's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
He did it all for little old me.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down,
he said. Shame, filled with guilt.
what I love about our amazing Savior. It doesn't matter how much shame you feel. It doesn't matter how much guilt you feel. He still said you was worth it. Understand, none of us are worthy of this calling. The Bible says while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We were ungodly. There was nothing great about us, but Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. He came for you. He came for me. God, I'm just grateful for your love. Because there's nobody like you, God. There's nobody like you, God. There's nobody like you, God. No one can love me like you do, Lord. Yeah, nobody can love me like you do, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your compassion. Thank you for thinking that I was worth it. Thank you for your grace. And God, I thank you for your mercy. Lord, let us respond responsibly, God. The only response to a reckless love is that of obedience. Obedience, God, of greater sacrifice, to know that it's not about my will or my desires. Lord, help to shape, mold, and conform us, God, that our will isn't what we want, but Lord, that we seek your will for our lives, that your will becomes my will, that your desires are my desires, and in your desires, God, we take pleasure in your desires, and your will is the fullness of joy, Lord, under your shadow, God, Lord, with you is where we find peace, dwelling in the secret place of the Most High, our Almighty God. We love you, we honor you, God. Hear our hearts, God. Lord, if there's anyone who's watching this broadcast, Lord, who may have fallen, God, who may have strayed away, or who may not even know you and have a desire to get to know about this amazing Jesus that we're singing about, touch their hearts, God. Lord, remind them, let them know, Lord, that there's no shadow you won't light up, Lord. Even in their darkest nights, in their darkest moments, God, that you are the light of the world, God. You are able to light up the darkest places. God, we're so grateful for your love. We honor you. We thank you. God, we just ask that you receive our worship. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. And we ask it all. Amen.
What's going on, Faith Community Bible Church? This is your pastor, Pastor Mike Bird. And today I have the privilege to give you your announcements for this week. So much going on, so much happening. First off, we're just thankful that you chose Faith Community as your place of worship today.
Thanks.
As you can see, I got my main man, Deacon Cortez Red Willis, in this video with us, right? So just a couple of things just to share with you guys. Number one, make sure that you guys are joining us every Monday, Wednesday, Friday for prayer beginning at 6:30. You can join us by going to fcbcstl.com/prayer. We do a quick devotion and then we pray. It has been dynamic. Last week, we finished reading through 1 Thessalonians, so we're being extremely intentional with that time. Also, I just want to say thank you to everybody that joined us last week for our parking lot service. Man, it was so great to see many of you, and I'm so thankful for everything that the Lord is doing at Faith Community. It is so amazing, and in the event that you missed the major announcement, check this out. The Lord has been doing great things during COVID for Faith Community, so much so that Faith Community now owns its building. Woo! We own the building, right? And God is, again, God is doing such great things. And for us to steward this space well, I'm going to pass it over to Deacon Willis, and he's going to make an announcement about that.
All right, family. How y'all doing? So this announcement is on Saturday. October 10th.
I hope so.
Saturday, October 10th at 10 o'clock, we will be doing a deep cleaning of the church, all right? It's our responsibility as the church to upkeep the church, right?
Yeah.
So We need people to sign up to come help us deep clean the inside. We're gonna have some people outside cleaning up the outside so that once we're ready to re-enter, the church will be ready. All right. That sign up sheet will be coming to y'all Monday. No later than Monday at fcbcstl.com/signup. Be looking for that sign up sheet.
Awesome, awesome. Again, October 10th at 10 a.m. starting tomorrow. That's Monday, starting tomorrow. Sign up at fcbcstl.com/signup. Mark your calendars for October 10th to join us for that. Y'all, as we prepare our hearts and minds for the preached word, y'all, I have a privilege today to present a young man to you who has shown himself faithful since he's been here at Community. Yeah. Pastor Brandon has shown himself dependable, has shown himself to be a student of the word, and the Lord led Pastor Brandon to come here at Faith Community to do his residency as he prepares to plant a church in Maryland Heights. Yeah. So if y'all don't mind, put your hands together, hit some likes on the screen, and show some love for my friend, my brother, Pastor Brandon Boatner, the pastoral resident here at Faith Community. Yeah. Bow your heads with me and let's pray for Pastor Brandon as he preaches today. Deacon Willis, why don't you go ahead and pray for Brandon today?
All right. Lord God, we come before you. Thank you for this opportunity to come before you today, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you for sending us Pastor Brandon, Lord God.
Yeah.
We ask that you give him Holy Ghost boldness, Lord God, to proclaim your word as you called him to, Lord God.
Yes.
Give him the courage and the strength and the strategy to go forth as you need him to. And all these things we pray in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Pastor Brandon, preach the word. So excited, y'all. The next voice you will hear will be that of my friend and my brother, Pastor Brandon Boatner. Faith Community, God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. Let's enjoy the word together.
It's awesome to be here today. Hey, if you're online and you're joining us, how about that worship today? That was something good, right? It was good to worship with you today. We're worshiping the one true Savior, Jesus Christ, and that's important to me. I want people to look at my life and be able to see the reflection of Jesus, that he has changed me. Y'all, if y'all used to know me, you wouldn't have liked me. I'm going to be honest. You wouldn't have liked me, but Jesus did a work in my life, and he can do a work in your life. Amen? Hey, it's an honor to stand here today at Faith Community Bible. And I want to give you three reasons why, real quick. Number one, listen to this. Pastor Bird has laid a foundation of clinging to God's truth. Right? This church preaches the Bible. Hey, y'all, and that's more unusual than you would think it should be. Because I've been around the block a few times, and I've heard some pastors, and I've heard some ideas that didn't come out of this book. But Pastor Bird, no, he laid that foundation for us. Let me give you number two. Pastor Bird guards the witness of this pulpit. Not just anyone gets to get up here and speak. If someone speaks, they have the seal of our pastor. And that's good. Let me give you number three, because this is a church that has stayed the course during these difficult times. You've been faithful, church. You've been faithful. You've come to see that the church is not a building, but it's a people on mission. That's right. Hey, I'm Pastor Brandon Boatner. I'm the church planting resident, and I'm so excited to share God's word with you today. So if you have your Bible, why don't you turn to Acts 17? And as you're turning there, let me give you a little context, because context is key. Listen, as you find your spot, I want to tell you about a man named Paul. Now, Paul was an apostle. Now, that means he was a sent one who was sent by Jesus himself to tell the world that they're sinners in need of a Savior. And he even told them a name. His name is Jesus. And if you believe in him, you can have eternal life. In Acts 17, Paul is traveling. And he moves through Philippi and Amphipolis and Apollonia and Thessalonica. Hey, and if you don't know those names, that's cool. Here's what I want you to know. This was a man dedicated to be an ambassador for Jesus. Seriously, like the distance he traveled in just our scripture was over 100 miles. He would have been traveling like 35 miles a day on foot. He was convicted to tell people about Jesus. And you know what? That convicts me, because sometimes I stumbled across the street to tell people about Jesus. But Paul lived out his faith. He wasn't trying to just be a neighbor. He wasn't trying to just loan some sugar to somebody. He desired to be the salt and the light to the world that is bitter and stuck in darkness. And in a way, Paul turned this world upside down, and you can too. This is our context as we approach. And I'm going to read these words to you. We're in chapter 17, verses 1 through 12. Here's what it says. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis, Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul went in, as was his custom. And on three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, "This Jesus whom I proclaim to you, that's Christ." And some of them were persuaded, and they joined Paul and Silas, as did many of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women. But those Jews were jealous. And they took some wicked men of the rabble, and they formed a mob. They set the city in an uproar. They attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. And when they couldn't find them, they just dragged Jason and some of his brothers before the city authorities. And they were shouting, "These men who have turned this world upside down have come here also, and Jason has received them. And they're acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there's another king named Jesus." And the people in the city authorities were disturbed when they heard these things. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. And this last part's for context, but the brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they went into the Jewish synagogue, because that's what they do. And they went to the Jews, and these Jews were more noble than the ones at Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. And many of them therefore believed, with not a few Greek women of high standing as well as men. Hey, I'm about to pray for our teaching. I'm going to do something a little different. Wherever you're at, will you do something for me? Because I'm not able to give God's word without God moving. Do you know that? Could you pray in your heart for me? And then I'll pray. Pray in your heart for me, please. Father God, I come to you. And God, I said, I'm not able. You are everything. Lord, would you speak through this broken vessel that people could know your glory, that people could know your goodness, that people could know that there is a way that is better, a purpose driven. Lord, would you speak through me that maybe there's someone that doesn't even know you today, and they'll come face to face with the living God in such a way that their life will be forever transformed. God, would you work? Would you work, God? As only you can do, because I can't do it. I can't hype somebody to Jesus, but you can move their heart. You can change death into life. God, that's only you, and only you can do that. God, will you move today? We implore you, God, please move. And we just lift up this time before you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, who is my Savior. Amen. And amen. Hey, it's good, like I said, to be here to speak with you guys. And I've been thinking for quite some time about these words. And I just want to start by saying a couple of things. One is this. Some of you guys have kids. And they got some incredible toys out right now. Y'all seen these toys? My son, he has this thing that he gets on and he can lean forward and it moves him forward. He leans back and it moves him back. I tried to get on it. I almost killed myself. I'm going to be honest with you. And I walk outside and I see my boy. This is too much, y'all. This is way too much. I walk outside and I see my boy playing basketball on his hoverboard. Now, that's lazy, but it's amazing. I'm going to be honest with you. Now, when I was a kid, we had some cool toys, too. We had some awesome things. We used to have that N64 and all that good stuff. But but I'll tell you what, some of the simple stuff is what got to me. I remember when I was real little, they had this thing called a CNC. You remember this thing? Like, it was a circle and had like a handle. You pull the handle down, had a little arrow, and it would go around, had animals, and you would pull it and it would be like, the duck goes quack, right? It was always the worst accent. Like, farmers actually talk like that. They don't. But, you know, the cow goes moo, and you pull that thing, man. But I always had that little imagination. And when I got bored of it, I remember, do y'all ever do this? Where I took it and I put it on its side and all of a sudden it was a turntable. Right? And you pull the side, you put your hand on there, all of a sudden that duck goes squiggity, squiggity, quack. Right? You with me? Man, I remember that. I remember that. I remember this Etch-a-Sketch. Y'all ever have an Etch-a-Sketch? Y'all had an Etch-a-Sketch? Man, you got on there, you thought you were going to be like a Michelangelo or a Leonardo, one of the other turtles. I don't know. Like, you thought you was going to get on there and make something good. Every diagonal line looked like lightning bolts, didn't it? You couldn't. Mama's face looked like she done got shocked or something. Then after a while, what did you do with that? You got tired, like you weren't going to make nothing great. So you were like, I want to see how this thing works. And so you made a little square. And you realized you could scratch out line by line like you were mowing. Move it over a little bit, scratch it out. And before you know it, you had this square and you could look into the inner workings of this Etch-a-Sketch. And that was cool. That was real cool until what happened till you put it down and your brother or your sister came by. And what did they do? They shook it up. They done ruined your weekend. They done ruined your week and they shook it up. Hey, in our verses, we see something like that Etch-a-Sketch. Paul begins his work in peace. He's making these lines, these inroads into people's lives. He's creating a window for them to see their own sin, for them to see their need for a Savior, and his name is Jesus. But the Jews were jealous. The Jews, they create chaos, and they shook everything up. They shook up the city into a mob. Catch how nearsighted this is, church. That's how sin works. Sin creates destruction. And the Jews, while in a mob, they lay this claim that Paul's turning the world upside down. The Jews are the ones shaking the Etch-a-Sketch. Well, then why are they claiming that Paul's turning the world upside down? It's because Paul is changing their normal. Church, people get used to their own sin, their own darkness, and that becomes their normal. What did Jesus say? He said, I've come into the world as a light so that whoever believes in me may not remain in darkness. So we offer the light of Jesus. Yet more are content just to live in their trash, to live in their sin. And Jesus said this, and John actually says, Jesus came to his own and his own did not receive him. What should we do? How do we impact the world then? Christian, you should be intentional with your life. Listen, your life matters. We continue to be a light in the darkness. We continue to change people's lives. We continue to fight the good fight. And yes, we continue to turn this world upside down. At least that's how those that embrace darkness see it. Y'all, we ain't crushing skulls and throwing jabs. Which is good. I might win that one, but I'm just saying, no, it's good. We ain't doing that. We come in truth. We come in peace. We come in love. We come in generosity, but those elements don't line up with sin. We turn this sinful world upside down. Here's my main point. This is what the main point of the day is, y'all. Following Jesus means turning this sinful world upside down. Following Jesus means turning this sinful world upside down. We should be causing a little chaos for Christ. You with me? We should be getting involved and telling the devil to go where he belongs. James tells us, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Well, you know what? Sometimes we got to speak for other people. Let's get into our text and learn more about this. Go back to verse 1. I like to walk through the text like Pastor does. We're in verse 1 and verse 2. Here's what it says. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews, and Paul went in, as was his custom. And on three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the scriptures. Remember, Paul has been walking for miles and miles and miles, but what does Paul do when he arrives in his location for ministry? He had a custom. He had a custom. He had a system that worked for him. Paul would go to the town. He would attend the Jewish service on a Saturday because, you know, they had church on Saturday. He would wait for his opportunity to speak. And then he would speak. And he would reason. And he reasoned for 3 days because they kept inviting him back for 3 consecutive Saturdays in a row. He reasoned the scriptures. Listen, out of the bat, I want to give you 2 points. Here's point number one. How you say something is as important as what you have to say. How you say something is as important as what you have to say. Paul came in peace. He joined their service. He waited patiently for his turn. And then he reasoned. That means he walked through the truth of the Bible with these people. What do we see built into this custom? Y'all, we see peace and truth. We see faithfulness, goodness. I hope this sounds familiar. We see kindness and self-control. Paul is living out his fruit from a relationship with God that he has. And Paul writes this in Romans. He says, if it's possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Receive this. Paul came in peace. I want y'all to lay that down. Paul came in peace. That's important. Hebrews 12, 14 says, pursue peace with everyone. This is the way that Paul came. How you say something is important is what you have to say. Why the uproar then? Listen, this is good. It wasn't because of how Paul said something, it's what he had to say. When people come to me with their issues, I try to give them scripture. Because they ain't disagreeing with me. If they go against that, they're disagreeing with God. And that don't work out for nobody. They don't work out for nobody. So what's Paul teaching? What's he teaching from? He used the scriptures. Listen, here's point number two immediately. Church, your teaching will only be as good as your source. Your teaching will only be as good as your source. Listen, I've been blessed to be around our pastor for some time now. And he teaches from the Bible. And I teach the truth of the Bible, the authority of God's word. And there's a lot of other sources. I said that earlier. There's a lot of sources people go into. They go to Oprah, don't they? And they go to Steve. They go to Steve Harvey, man. They go to their emotions. They go to this political platform for their system of truth. They speak what mommy and daddy taught them. Receive this, church. The scriptures are the same today as they were yesterday. Because God is the same yesterday, today, and for eternity. When feelings change and the truth of men die, the word of God will be strong. That's our source. That's our source, isn't it? How you say something is as important as what you have to say. And your teaching will only be as good as your source. Hey, I got a question for you. Could you reason and show that Jesus is the answer using the Bible? If you're a Christian, a follower of Jesus, I just want to challenge you to have a few verses in your back pocket to deliver to people. Why? Because Peter said this, in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy. Always be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks for the reason of your hope. We have to have a defense. But hey, I got to hold up for a moment. What scriptures was Paul using? Church, he only had the Old Testament. Paul had such a strong knowledge of the Old Testament that he was proving Jesus is the Messiah with just these texts. Now, I'm going to be honest. Like, I could take the Roman road and I can take you to Jesus. I can preach John 3:16. I can take you to different spots. But you know what? Can I lead you to Jesus from Leviticus? Hey, we all got some spots to grow, don't we? We all got some spots to grow. How you say something's as important as what you have to say, and your teaching will only be as good as your source. So what was Paul teaching? Look at verse 3. Let's read that together. Verse 3 says this, Paul is explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, this Jesus whom I proclaim to you, he is the Christ. The message from Paul was that Jesus is the Christ. Christ means anointed one. Basically, here's what he's saying. Paul is saying Jesus is the Son of God. He came to the world knowing that he is the answer to our sin problem. Somebody just said, hey, what sin problem? Well, let me tell you about it. God is a perfect judge, and one day you're going to face him for all the actions in your life. And most people, they like to tell me, well, that's all right, because I lived a good life. I'm going to be all right. Well, first, you ain't the judge. Romans 3:10 says, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away and have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. You see, what we call good really ain't. And I use the improper English on purpose. Hey, I didn't say God was good anyway. God's perfect. God's a perfect judge, y'all. Heaven's a perfect place. The measure isn't how good I have been, which the Bible says you haven't. The measure is, have I been perfect? I don't care what your grandma says about you. You ain't perfect. So God made a way because only God can. Somebody said, well, there ain't no way. You're right, there ain't no way. Not on our own accord, but God made a way. God made a way as only God can. He came to earth in the form of Jesus. He lived a perfect life to show that he was God. He was crucified on the cross, having taught us that that action was him paying for our sins, paying for the sins of anyone that would make him Lord of their life. He suffered on the cross, Paul said. 2 Corinthians, for our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Church received this. Do you remember in school how they graded on a curve? God doesn't grade on a curve. God grades on a cross. In verse 3 of Acts 11, Paul reasoned and he explained that Christ had to suffer, but that's not it. Jesus didn't just die and stay dead. Jesus rose from the dead. Jesus in 3 days rose, and Ephesians 2:5 shows that he now offers life to anyone that will place their faith on him. That's powerful. If you're listening and you don't know him, that's more powerful than you could ever imagine. How did Paul's audience react, y'all? Look at verse 4 with me. Here's what it says in verse 4. And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women. Paul was turning the world upside down. Some Jews accepted Christ, it says. And then there were some Gentiles that became Jews, and they also accepted Christ. And then there was a whole bunch of women that were leaders in the community, and they accepted Christ. And what are we told by this? We should be having a party. They were having a party in the name of Jesus as people were coming to a saving faith in him. People were moving from death to life. They were making Jesus their Lord and Savior. There was a revival breaking out in the town of Thessalonica. And all of this because Paul was faithful to present Jesus and give folks a decision to know him or not. Here's my third point for the day, guys. Church, when you are faithful to present Jesus, people always have a decision to make. When you are faithful to present Jesus, people always have a decision to make. They have to choose Jesus or they have to choose sin. And this is probably the reason why so many get angry when Christ is presented. People love to live in their happy ignorance. They don't want to speak up. They don't want to act up. They don't want to think deeply. And they won't until those issues impact them in their lives. It sounds a lot like what's going on in our world, if I'm honest. There's poverty in our world. People ignore it. There's racism and prejudice. People ignore it. There's unequal health care. People ignore it. Hey, y'all, I want to tell you a quick story about your pastor. It's a good story. It ain't bad, I promise, because he could rush this stage and tackle me right now. Y'all, I ain't going to do that. Hey, the first time I ever had a meal with Pastor Bird, he was nice enough to sit down with me. And I was writing a dissertation, and I was learning more about prejudice and discrimination, especially in St. Louis, because I'm originally from Texas, right? Y'all don't hate me for that. I still love the Cowboys, which means I still roll. You know, I try my best. But, hey, Pastor Bird, he went out with me, and you know where we went? We went to Goody Goody Diner. Yeah. If y'all ain't been around, y'all don't know what that is. Chicken and waffles. No, we sat down, hey, and we talked. And Pastor Bird, he said a lot of things that hit me really hard. A lot of things that hit me really hard. But one of the ideas that he told me, he said, you know, Brandon, most white people in the suburbs, they like to watch the news and they turn the news on. And they see a shooting. They see some bad thing that's happened in the city. But then what do? They turn off their TVs and they go back to bed. Pastor Bird said, Brandon, we can't turn off the TV. This is our life. We live it every day. And from our conversation, I had a decision to make. I could be one of the people that lives in the suburbs and turns off my TV, or I could be moved towards action as I believed God was doing in my life. And I hope you know what I chose, because I'm standing right here. Be a part of the solution, not a part of the problem. Y'all, we come in peace and love, but people in sin don't want to see truth. They don't want to be forced to make a decision, but faithful Christians, they got to force a decision. When you are faithful to present Jesus, people have a decision to make. We might be turning their world upside down, but listen, we do it out of love. We do it because we care. We want them to know truth and peace. And you know what? This life matters, but we want them to know eternal life. I want their eternity to be sure. But sin does not live in peace or love. Let's look and see. How did those against God react? Check out verse 5 with me. Here's what it says in verse 5. But the Jews were jealous, and taking some wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob. They set the city in an uproar. They attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. Hey, church, y'all ever been called a hypocrite? You ever been called a hypocrite? Someone might say, hey, you call yourself a Christian, but you're just a hypocrite. Man, they don't know what a hypocrite means. They say, you call yourself a Christian, you struggle with the same sins as me. You're a hypocrite. No, they don't know. Christians, we realize that we are impacted by sin. But we ain't hypocrites because we are striving each day to better ourselves. We're fighting the good fight. We're doing our best every day to get better. Being a sinner doesn't make me a hypocrite. It makes me a human, and God still loves me. And God still loves you. What's true hypocrisy? That's when you proclaim you are one thing and you live out something totally different. That's hypocrisy. And can we just for a minute focus on the hypocrisy within these verses? And it's coming from those that are against God. The Jews are screaming that Paul is turning the world upside down. The Jews are creating a mob. The Jews are jealous. They're the one that hire wicked men, criminals. The Jews are the one attacking and causing damage. That's hypocrisy. But hey, y'all, it's expected. Do you know why? Here's my fourth point. When Christ gains fame, sinners get jealous. When Christ gains fame, sinners get jealous. There's going to be some heated conversations with me sometimes because I'm going to refuse to halt the name of Jesus to make you feel better about your own sin. In Acts 4, look this up sometime. You got Peter and Paul, and they are arrested and they're brought to this council, and they're told to stop speaking of Jesus. Here's what it says. So they called them and charged them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered them, well, whether it's right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than God, you be the judge. But we cannot but speak of what we've seen and heard. We're going to preach Jesus, y'all. Remember, when you're faithful to present Jesus, people always have a decision to make. So with discernment and in love, we preach the name of Jesus until one day I get to go home and be with Jesus. Yeah. When Christ gains fame, sinners get jealous. Back to our text. These Jews, man, they're jealous. And they're clinging to their emotion for guidance and truth. And what kind of hypocrisy do we continue to see? Man, they hired these wicked men of the rabble. They formed a mob. They set the city in an uproar. They attacked the house of Jason. Here's a recap. Look, if you were out eating a BLT and you missed the first half of this sermon, I'm gonna recap you right now. Listen, here's what happened. Here's what happened so far. Paul traveled to a town because he cared, because he's faithful to God. He waited for an opportunity to speak. He took his turn. He spoke Christ in peace. He reasoned from the Old Testament in truth. He offered the message to everybody. That's women and Gentiles, and that's a bigger deal than you know. And those that were defiant to God, what did they do? They got angry. They got jealous. They picked up some criminals willingly. They created a mob to cause chaos. As we move forward, they're going to speak lies against God's servants and demand a trial of the innocent. That's hypocrisy, and that seems clear. It shows the depth of sin built into these people. They could be shouting, and an apple is yellow and a banana is red, and they believe if they shout it loud enough, it's going to be true. Hey, here's our fifth point. He who screams loudest is not truest, just an emotionalist. I had to go look that one up. That's proper grammar, y'all. That's proper grammar. You can say she too. She who screams loudest is not truest, just an emotionalist. That means they use emotion as their guide and as their truth and as their center of moral reasoning. Emotion is not a faithful guide, though. I know a pastor, he would say this. He says, emotion's a good caboose, but it's an awful engine. It should not guide you. It can push you along, but you need truth. And that's why your source matters so much. We're seeing so many people using emotion as their main source of truth, and that will fail you. That'll fail you. But hey, we can turn the world upside down just by using love, peace, and presenting truth. That'll do, y'all. That'll do. Verses 6 through 7. Let's get back in our word. Here's what it says. And when they could not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities, shouting, "These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also, and Jason has received them, and they are acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus." Hey, y'all, check this out. The Jews are trying to utter lies, but they got some parts right. The Christians did not act against Caesar, but they do serve another king. Point number 6, your loyalty will fall on whoever you bow your knee to. Your loyalty will fall on whoever you bow your knee to. This means the person. This means the idea. This means the political group. This means the subject matter. And yes, this means the sin that you deem worth following. Wherever you put your loyalty on, that's where you bow your knee, and that has your allegiance. Look, I'm only going to say this one time. We should only pledge our allegiance to God. Those defiant to God place their hope in the things of this world, y'all. And what do they find? They find emptiness and chaos dressed up like royalty. That's what they find. They find emptiness and chaos dressed up like royalty. There's only one true king. His name is Jesus. So we bow our knees to the God that gives peace and understanding. He gives wisdom and shows no partiality. He gives justice and, yes, wholeness. Who do you bow your knee to? In this season of our history, I think that's a question I want to ask with every decision I make, every turn of my page. I want to know, who do you bow your knee to? When you observe in your life, who do you bow your knee to? Is it old girl? Is it your work? We bow our knee to Jesus. Jesus has the power to save. Jesus has the power to move. Jesus has the power to change our lives. We only bow our knee to King Jesus. Verse 8. And the people and the city authorities were disturbed when they heard these things. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. Hey, y'all, I don't want to say a lot right here, but I will say this. I just find it funny how money greases the palms of those that consider themselves integrity and justice people. I just find that funny. That's all. And we, times haven't changed, have they? Money's a god that people follow. Money's a god that people follow. Verse 10. Then the brothers, they immediately sent Paul. Paul was sent away. What did he do? He sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they went into the Jewish synagogue. Now, these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. And many of them therefore believed, with not a few Greek women of high standing as well as men. What did Paul do? There's a giant mob. He gets ushered out of a city. Man, he does what we do. He goes into the next city after brushing himself off, and he gets after it. He gets after it. That's what we do. He stayed on mission. Why? Because Paul knew how you say something is as important as what you have to say. Paul knew your teaching will only be as good as your source. Paul knew when you are faithful to present Jesus, people will always have a decision to make. Paul knew when Christ gains fame, hey, sinners get jealous, but that's life. Paul knew he who screams loudest is not truest, just an emotionalist. And Paul knew your loyalty will fall on whoever you bow your knee to. And Paul was bowing his knee to King Jesus. This turn the simple world of the Thessalonians upside down. And this can change our world even today. Hey, if you're wondering about those Thessalonians, y'all, there's a couple letters in our Bible to them, first and second. You can go to First Thessalonians sometime and you can read and you can find out, hey, they had some stuff that they went up against, but they stayed strong. They stayed faithful. They had a good example. They clung to Jesus. Listen, I just want to transition real quick. If you want to be a Christian, a Christ follower, yeah, we have to live a life that turns this world upside down. But you know what? Maybe you're not a Christian. And maybe you've realized you ain't. Maybe you've never given your life to Jesus. Every time Jesus is taught, you must make a decision. I believe this, and I believe this fully, that you don't get online, that you don't listen to me preach today for no reason. God is moving in your life in such a way that he wants you to make a decision. He wants you to move. He wants you to know wholeness in life like you've never known it before. Why not choose to follow him even today? You may ask how. You take time right now, man. You take time right now, sister, to examine your heart. You confess that you're a sinner. We've already shown that you're a sinner. You need a Savior. You confess that Jesus is that Savior. You confess that you want to make him the Lord of your life. You want to bow your knee to King Jesus. You cast your sin on the cross. He's already paid your debt. You believe Jesus rose from the grave. And lastly, tell somebody that you did this. Tell somebody your decision. Hey, listen up. Some of you are going to say, Brandon. Some of you are going to say, Brandon, I'm good. I know all that. I know all that. You may have it in your brain. You may have heard it from your parents. You may have heard it in Sunday school. You may have heard it in church growing up. You know all that. But listen, you may have never known that the difference in heaven and hell is about 12 inches. That's the space from your mind to your heart. Knowing is not believing. It's time to believe. It's time to change. Believe today. We're going to pray this out. Thank you for listening. I hope God's moved in your life. Let's pray. Father, you are wonderful, and we come before you, Lord, very humbly because you're the God that changes lives, Lord. We sung about you earlier, Lord. We sung about you. Climbing mountains, shining light in the darkness. But God, the biggest thing of all is that you went on the cross of Calvary for me and my sins, that you became sin who knew no sin, that if I cast my faith on you, that I can be saved, Lord. That's the biggest test. Thank you for that, Jesus. And you died, and God, in 3 days you rose. You are the living King. So many people, Lord, serve a dead king. They serve a dead prophet. They serve a dead idea. You are the living God, Lord. Would you move in the hearts of the people listening today that we could not turn our eyes from you? No, not this time. That we wouldn't just know you are God, but we would believe it in our hearts and we would see it in our lives and we would be compelled to turn this world upside down for you. Lord, we lift this time up before you. You are holy and good. And I thank you for the opportunity, as always, to preach your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Listen. If you're watching on this screen today, if you're here behind this camera, right? If you're watching the screen, I need you to throw some hearts, some likes, some hand claps, some amen, Brandons. That was a tremendous, tremendous, tremendous word today from Acts 17. Pastor Brandon, thank you, man, for your faithfulness to the word. Thank you for sharing with us today, y'all. I'm encouraged to know that even today we have folks here who can preach and give me a break, right? I'm thankful that the Lord chose Faith Community for Pastor Brandon to hang his hat until he plants. And I'm going to tell you this, the gospel was preached today. And if you're here and or you're watching this and you want to give your life to Christ, go to our website. Fill out a virtual response card, fcbcstl.com/respond. We want to pray for you. If you want to have a conversation with myself or Pastor Brandon about what it looks like to have a relationship with Jesus, go there, fill out that virtual response card, and we will reach back out to you. Also, if you want to give to support the ministry of Faith Community Bible Church, you can do so by going to fcbcstl.com/give. Here at Faith Community, we exist to make Christ known in the community by caring for the community. And we are thankful that you guys have been faithful in your giving, faithful even in your attendance over these last several months as we've been virtual. Y'all, I'm excited that the Lord is using Faith Community, not only to see men raised up, but to see women raised up to live life on mission, to give him glory in all things. Do me a favor, y'all. Make sure y'all are continually praying for Pastor Brandon as he's trained up here as a resident. Not only call out the name of Brandon, y'all, that is the first of many sermons that you guys will hear from Pastor Brandon. I cannot wait to unleash this man on a Wednesday night to teach. Brandon, y'all, he's going to choke me out for telling y'all this, but Brandon actually has his PhD, right? Brandon is actually a doctor. It wasn't donated. It was earned. He said it was earned. You can tell by his student loans, right? But Brandon wrote his dissertation. What was your dissertation on again? Remind me. Leading a white church to understand multiculturalism. It's about close to 400-page dissertation that I actually printed out. I'm about halfway through with it now, right? But it is amazing. This man, Brandon is smart. He's a go-getter. He's a self-starter. And Brandon came here, y'all, with the desire to plant a multi-ethnic church in Maryland Heights. And Brandon has been led of the Lord to call this church Remix Church, okay? So we are praying with Brandon. We are also praying, y'all, with his wife, Julie, and his boys, as they not only surrender to Jesus, but as they answer the call to plant a church alongside Faith Community, planting Remix Church. Brandon, thank you today. Thank you today for coming on mission with us to help turn this world upside down. Amen. Turn it upside down for Jesus. Y'all, just before we log off today, just a reminder, October 10th will be Building Cleanup Day. Building Cleanup Day. There will be a live sign up going out tomorrow, fcbcstl.com/signup. We want to know how many people will be here, so Deacon Willis will know how to divide those teams. So tomorrow we will make sure that sign up gets posted in all groups. That sign up will be posted in our Facebook page and all of that. Those of you who aren't involved in those groups, we will also make sure it's posted on our public Facebook page so that you too can be a part of what God is doing here at Faith Community. Listen, we love you guys. We miss you guys. Continue to pray for us as we aim to make Christ known in the community by caring for the community. God bless you guys. God keep you is our prayer. Again, Pastor Brandon, thank you so much for preaching today. Julie, thank you so much for lending him to us and allowing him. Yeah, she allows him to serve at Faith Community. Julie, we love you and thankful for you and the boys as well. God bless you all. God keep you is our prayer. Have a great rest of the day. Oh!